Scientists here at the University of Nebraska Medical Center believe they can restore function in the limbs of children with cerebral palsy. And to do this, they're using infrared light.
So what's in the headgear is that it has a bunch of light sensors in there, and the light goes through the skin and the skull, and it measures the oxygenation that's in that area. For children with the hemiplegic cerebral palsy, what happens is they have impairments on one side of their body. And then what they do, or they tend to do, is they neglect the use of that hand and they use the good arm. And the objective here is try to improve the function or the usage of that impaired arm. The headband is measuring the change in the oxygen within the brain that underlies that flexible sensor that we have. And that's going to tell us how his brain is working while he's actually completing this task.
In the garden.
Perfect. How about the puppy? Woof, woof.
Hey, it's really play, essentially. So the child is playing and doing a variety of activities, but they are encouraged to use that more impaired hand to do those activities, and that the hands are working together to do the activities. And so his task here is to grab the shapes and to position them in the right position on the little puzzle we have. Yeah, so what is happening with the brain is that the region that we're sampling, yay, it's actually related to his cognition and how he does problem solving. And that's what we are measuring. What the traces are, they represent the changes in the amount of hemoglobin that's oxygenated within the brain. So an increase would indicate, you know, greater oxygenation, and a decrease would be related to deoxygenation. And overall, what we see is that bad arm, or the more impaired arm, is improving its function. They're actually able to use it better in single context or together. In addition, what we see is that there are parallel changes within the brain that are occurring that are associated with those motor changes. The really cool thing about it, though, is that those changes are occurring in the areas that control your cognition, your thinking, your reasoning, and how you problem solve, which suggests that maybe a change in the motor system opens up resources actually for you to think better, to solve problems better.
There are plenty of theories of why physical activity can benefit the mind as well as the body, but the Omaha scientists insisted that hard data were needed. Functional near-infrared spectroscopy gave them a tool for monitoring children's brains while they were doing hand-arm bimanual intensive therapy, HABIT for short.
So this is an example of hand-arm bimanual intensive therapy. She's doing fine manual task. So the task is to put the beads in the string. And as you can see, her right hand is acting as a stabilizer to stabilize and hold the string, whereas she is manipulating those beads with her left hand. So this is an example how her both hands are incorporated in this task. And she's repeating the task several times so that it can be an example of part-time practice where she's working on different beads and completing the task. See, if you can see, she is nicely stabilizing the tube with her right arm, because the tube is really stabilized, and then she is working with her left hand to put the cloth inside. So this is another example of bimanual task. What the child is doing here, she is pulling the cloth out of a tube. What we are working on here is her affected arm is a stabilizer, and the less affected arm is a manipulator. So we are working more on the stabilization component with the affected arm. Then she is basically thinking how to pull the cloth. So this involves a lot of processing in the form of like attention or some of the cognition component. Also simultaneously, she is working on the motor task. So it involves integration of cognitive and the motor task. The purpose overall here is to incorporate both hands in the activities so that children can learn to perform the bimanual task, which is helpful for their daily functioning.
In your protocol, you're using intense activity. So to what extent is the intensity of that activity important?
Yes, certainly the intensity is important. This is what we have found out from our study. It was 50 hours, which was spread 5 hours each day, 5 days a week for 2 consecutive weeks. And what we have found from this, children improved in their bimanual activities, also on their affected hand function. And not only this, but also their brain activation improved. So intensive activities or intensive therapies, they have their own roles in the terms of like high intensity or higher dose may drive better neural changes, which might change function.
You had an improvement. How big was that improvement?
We assess their function based on something called as assisting hand assessment. And the minimal change that is required to gain function is 5 points. In our study, what we found that children improved by 9 points, meaning that they significantly improved from pre to post in their hand functioning and bimanual coordination. Similarly, what we found in their brain with the brain activation study, that initially they might have required more cognitive resources, those decreased post-therapy, meaning that they were more efficient now in performing their motor task while simultaneously allocating their cognitive resources.
Now, where does cognition come into this, and how big a change or an improvement in cognition do you think you are achieving here?
Certainly, I mean, any motor task, it's a combination of cognition and motor. And other sensory motor processes. We have seen that from the brain activation study that their activation in the prefrontal cortex is decreased. Post-therapy, the amount of attentional and cognitive resources that they require to perform the task decreased. And certainly, I mean, that is how we can relate how motor and cognition is related, and cognition has a role.
So what do you think physical therapists can take away from your findings here?
One, that habit is a promising intervention to improve bimanual coordination, affected hand function. But along with that, it also helps in improving overall allocation of attentional resources or cognition that is required to perform the task. So if we think of like motor planning component, habit might be helpful in improving the planning, action planning, which is required for successful execution of the motor movement.
So in the case of children with hemiplegic cerebral palsy, you've got an improvement of function, improvement of cognition. Does this have any implications beyond cerebral palsy for the use of intensive physical therapy across the board?
Yes, I think it really does, because we tend to think of cerebral palsy or any type of motor disorder that it's motor centric, that the motor is the problem and that's what we need to address, and not considering these alternative things that are also occurring. So by treating the motor system, you open new windows actually for improved cognition and to be involved with your world.
So what are the clinical lessons coming out of your study?
Clinical lessons are that the immersive therapy, it really is beneficial, and it does tend to work or improve our motor actions that we have. But it also opens these parallel worlds or cognitive processes that you have. So you could actually improve a way a child thinks and works, and potentially how they're integrated or think at school, which is really interesting.
So what should physical therapists around the planet take away from this?
Well, one thing is that therapy is just not only a motor outcome. We are treating the motor system, but it will have these cognitive benefits, essentially, that couple it, which is really unique to this study.
This clear evidence that intense physical therapy brings great benefit to the brain brings hope in cerebral palsy, but perhaps also in many other situations.